Welcome back to Red Giant Real Lens Flare Beginner's Guide. We've previously seen the Designer, a great environment to simulate the look and accuracy for your lens flare. Once we've finished creating the look of our lens flare in the Designer, we can shift our focus on animating and deciding how our lens flare integrates within the shot using the available controls here on the Effect Control Panel. At the top, there are two important buttons. The Open Designer button that allow you to launch the Designer, and if you are using Real Lens Flare in After Effects, then you'll also see the Maxon Studio button, which allow you to launch Maxon Studio, our After Effects capsule engine with intuitive interface for creating stunning video fast. Check out this tutorial by my friend Chad Perkins about Maxon Studio.
Hey folks, Chad Perkins here for Maxon, and it is my pleasure and honor to be able to introduce to you a brand new tool called Maxon Studio that I believe is going to revolutionize the way that we all work in Adobe After Effects.
Now, back to Real Lens Flare control panel parameters. At first, you probably think that there are a lot of controls to understand. But if we fold all these folding arrows up, we can see that there are actually only 5 categories of controls available here. The light source, which controls the color and intensity of our light source, as well as its locations on the frame. The obscuration, which controls the behaviors of our lens flare when interacting with the background or foreground layers. Flare properties, which globally controls the flare size, angle, and brightness. Lens, which control the aperture size of our lens simulation, affecting the look and shape of our lens flare. And finally, the render settings, which you can use to set the quality of our lens flare. Choose fast to get the best performance when tweaking or animating your lens flare, and set it to extreme when you are ready to render out the best quality. You can also use the color mode to color manage your lens flare, and we'll get into that later. Let's take a look at the light source, which by default set to 2D position. Here you can change the locations of your lens flare simply by changing the X and Y value in the control panel or by dragging the on-screen control point to the location that you wish. Changing the flare location to 2D position and distance will add more complexity to positioning your lens flare, since now you can add depth control simply by using the distance control. The further the lens flare, the dimmer it gets, and the closer, the bigger and brighter it is. And when you need all the flexibility and complexity, this is where you want to use After Effects Light to drive your real lens flare. In the timeline, simply create an After Effects Light and change Locate Flare by AE Light. Notice that Real Lens Flare automatically detects the After Effects Light and attach itself to it. So now, anytime we move the light source, Real Lens Flare will move along with it, even when we're moving it in the Z-axis. Real Lens Flare will give you a correct and accurate result. I could also create another light. This time, I will opt to create Spotlight instead of Point Light. And for experiment purpose, let's also set it to red. And as soon as I click OK, Real Lens Flare is automatically attached to the newly created light. And as we rotate around the spotlight, we will see Real Lens Flare on our frame also propagating the color of the light source. We can also change the light options, and Real Lens Flare will honor the settings. For example, when we reduce the cone feather to 0, as we rotate the cone, Real Lens Flare will automatically be turned off as the cone blocks the travel directions of the light, so it is now in some sort of on or off state depending on the cone location. Meanwhile, as we increase the cone feather, it starts to realistically bleed into the edges and gradually showing the lens flare to the frame. So the option is really yours. There are some options in Real Lens Flare that you can use to set its light following behavior. The first light layer will literally tell Real Lens Flare to follow the topmost light on your composition. And first name light will tell Real Lens Flare to follow a name given to specific light. As we choose this option, notice that Set Light Name button is now active. We can now type in a specific name, for example, point, and Real Lens Flare will follow the light with that specific name in the composition. Currently, by the time of the recording of this video tutorial, Real Lens Flare light following behavior is still exclusive to After Effects. Now let's talk about the obscuration in Real Lens Flare. Here, we have the hidden mattebox control, which you can use to emulate the use of mattebox during filming to reduce flaring at certain angle. It generates the purple dotted line on the viewer, indicating the virtual mattebox boundary we are using. We can also, of course, change the width, height, and softness of our matte box. Now, as we drag our flare toward the edges of our frame, notice that it affects the shape and brightness of our flare reflection. Here without the matte box, and here with. As we park the light source halfway on the matte box edge, our reflection shape is also no longer in its perfect shape, and it is only halfway as bright. And as we completely park outside of the frame, we see no reflection of our flare. Here we have a different scene, and I have real lens flare applied to a black solid, which I set the blending mode to screen. So you can use real lens flare right away on your footage or in a solid layer and change its blending mode to screen. In real lens flare, there is this obscuration layer that you can use to pick a layer in your composition that you can use as the obscuration mat. We know that as light source moving behind an object in the scene, our flare shouldn't be at its full capacity flaring at our screen. And that is exactly what this obscuration layer allows you to do. So let's pick up a layer in our comp as the obscuration layer. Here I have a duplicate of my footage, which I renamed to matte. And I used coloristic here to qualify just the brighter part and set the key mode to show key. So the white area will pass through the flare while the black area will block it. With the default mode to obscure using luminance channel and with the invert function on, I can now tell Real Lens Flare to just pass through the effect on the window area, which was white on the mat, while it will be obscured by the curtains and the wall, which were blacks on the mat. By the way, I also set the obscuration layer to effect and mask so that Real Lens Flare will also detect the effect that I applied to the source footage, in this case, the coloristic here. So now, if I scrub the playhead, you'll see that the flare is now only happening on the window area, just like in real life. And here we have another beautiful scene donated by the great Stu Maswich. It is a nice render of the International Space Station, which was rendered using Redshift and Cinema 4D. It is a perfect scene to demonstrate a more sophisticated and subtle effect of real lens flare obscuration behavior. If we open the designer, we see that this lens flare has a light ball core projection to emulate the light source in the scene, as well as schmutz to emulate the look of dust resting on the surface of our lens. If we drag the playhead and park it around the end, we can see that the light source is now obscured by the part of the space station, but the flare is still peeking through it. And if we zoom in, we can see that now our obscured light source is not just one big blob of light, and each unobscured light source generate individual flares with different brightness and size according to the size and brightness of the individual visible light. This is what makes real lens flare really stand out, as this behavior is very hard to emulate using just the sprite-based lens flare effects. We can also see that the schmutz reflections is also reflecting the shape of the light source. Now to see this more clearly, let's move to the next scene. So here we have a black solid layer for our lens flare, and on top of that, a pre-comp layer that consists of a checkerboard, a text, and some simple shapes pre-comp as one layer. We are going to use this as our obscuration layer. I have set real lens flare to use this layer, which name obscuration mat in the comp, as the obscuration layer through the dropdown. I've also set it to source and obscure it using alpha. By the way, I have also increased the exposure of our flare reflection in the designer for us to observe these effects easier. Notice that as I am dragging my light source behind the checkerboard, we now can see that the flare reflection is also picking up the shape of the obscuring object. The same if I move my light source around the letters in the text, or when I locate the light source behind the intersections of these two rectangle shapes. So as you can see, real lens flare is very capable of simulating an accurate lens flare. That is the obscurations in real lens flare, a nice feature that you can use to make your lens flare more accurate and more believable. We've seen how to set up an obscuration layer in After Effects. Now let's go to Resolve and see how we can use the obscuration there. You may have seen that you can use real lens flare in different pages in Resolve. For a quick and easy lens flare tweak, you can use real lens flares in the edit page. Here, you'll have the obscuration function grayed out. So does when using real lens flare in the color page. You'll also see that the obscuration mode is grayed out. Fusion page in DaVinci Resolve is the perfect environment for you to use Real Lens Flare when you want the most out of Real Lens Flare. Here, we can definitely use the Obscuration mode for our lens flare. In this simple setup, I have a footage labeled as Media In 1, ported out to the Media Out 1, viewed on the right viewer in Fusion. I can decide to view this either on the left viewer by pressing 1 on my keyboard, or on the right viewer by pressing 2, and press 1 again to free the left viewer. Now let's solo the right viewer by pressing the rectangle icon on top of the right viewer. And also, let's add Real Lens Flare to our shot. Now hit the shortcut Shift Spacebar to open the Select Tool window and type in Real Lens Flare, then click Add. You can also browse the effect window and find Real Lens Flare under RG VFX category. Currently, with this setup, we still see that the obscuration layer is unavailable. But that's just because Real Lens Flare hasn't detected a matte to be used as the obscuration layer. If we hover over the blue input in Real Lens Flare node, you'll see that we can port in a mask here. And if we hover over the green input, we'll see that this is the obscuration layer input. So what we can do is that we can treat the same source footage as our obscuration matte. And in the node-based compositing like Fusion, we can use the same node to be output as many different things. Now let's add Brightness and Contrast node and port in the output of Media In 1 to the input of Brightness and Contrast. And the output of Brightness and Contrast will go to the Obscuration input. Now, you can see that Obscuration layer is available. Let's use the Multiple Viewer again this time and select the Brightness Contrast node and press 1 to send it to the left viewer. We want to create a simple black and white matte out of this image by setting the saturation to 0 and drag lift all the way down. Let's also reduce the gain slightly, and now if we scrub the playhead, we can see the window is all white while the curtain and the wall are black, perfect for our obscuration purpose. Now let's solo the right viewer again. And now as we play back the clip, we see that our flare is blocked by the curtain and the wall. That is how you can set up obscuration for Real Lens Flare inside DaVinci Resolve. And now if you move to the color or edit page, you can see the perfect result of our obscured Real Lens Flare. Now, probably the biggest question remains is that can Real Lens Flare be tracked? Well, absolutely. So here I have a scene with a forklift on a dock. Let's attach a lens flare to the light on top of the forklift. So what we want to do here in Fusion is to first track the camera movement and then feed the track data into Real Lens Flare as the location. In Fusion, we can do that simply by selecting the Media In 1 node and hit Shift Spacebar and type in TRA for tracker and hit Add. Notice that it will add a tracker node in our node setup. Here, I have the tracker set to IntelliTrack, and now all I have to do is to put the tracker target to the light on top of the forklift and press Track Forward. Once it's done, you can see that we have a track pass, and if I scrub my playhead, you'll see that the tracker is now attached to the forklift light. So now, all we need to do is to add Real Lens Flare on this tracker. Let's select the tracker node and press Shift Spacebar again and type in Real Lens Flare and hit Add. Now go to the 2D position and right-click and select Connect to IntelliTrack 1 Path Position. Now our Real Lens Flare is attached to the track light in Fusion. It's that simple. We can now open the Real Lens Flare designer and choose the flare that we like. For example, let's go with this Xeno preset propeller and reduce the brightness to 50%. We can also add ring core projection to our flare, and to make it more visible, let's add one stop of exposure to our ring core projection. And now, as we hit confirm, we can see that we have a nice Real Lens Flare perfectly tracked to the light source in the scene. There are many more that you can do here inside Fusion. I do encourage you to play around with it. Give it a spin. Post your results on the socials and don't forget to tag us. Have fun with Real Lens Flare, now also available in DaVinci Resolve. Stay tuned if you want to learn more about Real Lens Flare color management in the next video.